Hey, thanks to LastPass for sponsoring this video. Stick around to the end and find out more. Today, we're talking about one of the most important functions of a vehicle, right up there with going and not going. Steering! If we didn't have steering, we'd all just go in a straight line and never be able to turn, and that might work if the earth was flat. But it's not flat, you dummy. Steering covers a whole world of stuff, and there's no way I could fit everything there is to know about steering into one of these episodes, even if I used my secret blinking code, which I know none of you have figured out because I still haven't been rescued. So we're gonna focus on rack and pinion steering system and then take a look at steering angles. If y'all behave, we might have a very special guest. All right. Special guest is Dai Yoshihara. All right, rack and pinion steering gets mentioned all the time, but nobody talks about what it is. Well, because it's not really that special. I mean, it's how cars turn. But it sure sounds cool, huh? All it really means is there's a rack that gets moved by a pinion gear. That's it. It's a pretty simple mechanism used to convert rotation into linear motion. It really took off in the 70s when Arthur Ernest Bishop developed a variable ratio rack and pinion system. A rack and pinion gear set is enclosed in a metal tube, with each end of the rack protruding from that tube. A rod, called a tie rod, connects to each end of the rack. The pinion gear is attached to the steering shaft. When you turn the steering wheel, the gear spins, moving the rack. The tie rod at the end of each rack connects to the steering arm on the spindle. The rack and pinion gear set does two things. One, it converts rotational motion of the steering wheel into the linear motion needed to turn the wheels, and two, it provides a gear reduction, making it easier to turn the wheels. So this system allows a better road feel and requires less effort to turn. The car's pretty heavy, and when you're turning the wheel, you're fighting inertia. If you're moving, the car wants to go straight, and that wants to straighten the wheel. Some folks need a hand when it comes to turning, so that's where the power steering comes in.
You know, I would like to get a certain amount of self-steering.
And self-steering is when you let go.
I don't really let go, but you know,
spin in your hand.
Yeah, okay. Kinda, yeah.
Okay.
More the better, to be honest, because when we do like lock to lock, it's really quick. So if I try to feed, sometimes it's not fast enough.
In this case, part of the rack's modified to form a hydraulic piston and cylinder arrangement. The cylinder's fed on two sides by openings to which fluid lines are attached. The piston's connected to the rack and moves between these two openings. When pressurized fluid is fed to any one of the openings, the piston gets pushed and moves in the opposite direction, dragging the rack along with it. At the same time, the other opening vents out the fluid on the other side of the piston. This is how power is provided, which significantly minimizes the effort needed to steer your vehicle. The fluid's stored in a reservoir and gets pressurized with the help of a rotary vane pump driven by the car's engine through a belt and pulley arrangement. It pulls the low pressure fluid from the reservoir and pressurizes it before supplying it to the cylinder in the hydraulic steering system. So the fluid pressure does most of the steering work, while the driver controls the direction of the turn with the help of the valve system. We poked around on Dai's car and it ends up being that hang out with high horsepower monsters waiting for a run heats up your steering fluid, so it won't work right.
These guys sit in a line with cars running for like up to 3 hours straight. When you start boiling over the temperature of the power steering fluid, it starts to break down, so then your power steering gets weak and then it eats other parts inside the pump and you get cavitation, and you don't go this far sliding the car the wrong direction without power steering assisting.
And in your car, with a belt running off the engine, even if you're not turning the wheel, you're sucking a little power. So now we're seeing more and more electric power steering popping up to replace these old hydraulic bad boys. Electric power steering uses input from sensors on the steering wheel to apply assistive torque via an electric motor. Not only does this get rid of the drag on the engine from the hydraulic system, but this is part of the same system that gives us lane keep assist and camber control and crap like that from the car commercials that repeat all the time on Hulu. Okay, so what happens now when you turn the wheel? Your car turns, okay, but it's not one revolution to get the wheels to turn all the way. The steering ratio is the ratio of how far you turn the steering wheel to how far the wheels turn. For instance, if one complete revolution, or 360 degrees of the steering wheel, results in the wheels of the car turning 20 degrees, then the steering ratio is 360 divided by 20, or 18 to 1. I like those odds. A higher ratio means that you've got to turn the steering wheel more to get the wheels to turn a given distance. However, less effort's required because of the higher gear ratio. The gear ratio on most daily drivers choosing so that you got to make up 4 complete rotations of the steering wheel to get the wheels to turn from lock to lock. Generally, Lighter, sportier cars have lower steering ratios than larger cars and trucks. The lower ratio gives the steering a quicker response. You don't have to turn the steering wheel as much to get the wheels to turn the same distance. Dai's car takes only 1.5 turns to go from lock to lock. And lock to lock on this drift missile is 140 degrees. So he's got a steering ratio of 4 to 1.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow, I didn't even know.
It's crazy. And some cars have variable ratio steering, which uses a rack and pinion gear set that's got a different tooth pitch, that's the number of teeth per inch, in the center than it has on the outside. This makes the car respond quickly when it's starting a turn. The rack's near the center. And it also reduces effort near the wheel's turning limits. So now, let's get into steering angle. Steering angle can refer to two things. First, it can be the degree to which a wheel can turn, affecting the turn radius. This is something that's different on all cars, and it can be pretty easily modified, but we'll talk about that in a second. The second meaning of steering angle is the difference between the angle of the two wheels when turning. Why is this important? Now, your car and Dai's car have different problems to solve with that rack position. So let's start with normal people cars. As far back as carriages, people realized that the inside wheels and the outside wheels follow different paths. To correct this, we use what's called an Ackerman steering angle. It's named after Rudolph Ackerman, but he didn't invent it. It was invented by the German carriage builder George Lenkensperger in Munich in 1817. Ackerman just patented it in England for old Georgie. The solution of Ackerman steering is rather elegant. If you take the rack, slide it back, and angle your steering knuckle position inside 90 degrees, you'll see that the tires, when rotated, are at different angles. Now let's pull back. Here's a motorcycle going around a circle. It's just got two wheels, so there's none of the concerns we were just talking about. We're showing the path of the center of the rear tire. If we draw that line at 90 degrees from each tire, you see that the turn radius is the intersection of the angle of the front tire and the angle of the back tire. Easy peasy. You also see that the path of the front tire is slightly wider than that of the back tire. The longer the wheelbase, the greater this difference. Now, back to a car. The angle of the tire that'll create the least slippage is the tangent line to the circle at that point. It's different for the inside and outside tires. If it's a straight rack and pinion with a steering knuckle in line with the wheels are at the same angle to one another, and they'd slip. The elegant solution in Ackerman's patent was to move the rack back and place the steering knuckles in line with the center of the rear axle. Now, when turning the rack from left to right, you can see that the two wheels angle differently from one another. So while turning, the two tires have different angles and follow sliplessly along their respective paths. On cars, this connection is made with a tie rod that connects the rack to the steering knuckle. If you want to adjust how far your wheels can turn, you can move the rack forward or back. But the steering angle is still determined by the relationship of the knuckle to the spindle of the wheel. In racing, there's pro-Ackerman and anti-Ackerman setups. This is an oversimplification, but because friction is grip, sometimes you want your tires to grab more to determine sharp paths for the car rather than to follow them.
So a rack position further to the front
gives it what they would call like a crab walk, where both wheels are very parallel, so the thing can just go sideways.
Okay.
Versus it being back in this scenario, where it doesn't have as much equal Ackerman like steering angle, which kind of causes the car to follow a track more.
Oval tracks are more likely to use a pro Ackerman setup, but in sharp cornering tracks, it may be better to use anti Ackerman. But that's probably another video. Okay, now let's talk about drifters. No, people who race drift cars. Okay, first, you got so much crap up in those cars, you probably won't be using a traditional setup. Dai's car is right-hand drive. So he had to import a steering rack from a heavy-duty delivery truck that you can only find in China. That's research. But to fit everything around this and keep things from hitting anything else when he turns, the tie rods connect in front of the spindle. If you want to maintain an Ackerman setup, you continue the angle you had before the wheel in front of the wheel. But in drifting, you might not want an Ackerman steering angle. Remember, Ackerman's designed to help wheels follow a curved path. Some tracks will require a car to make a nice curved path around the turn, in which case the wheels should have different angles. But other courses couple these turns with super straight transition, where the car goes sideways behind the front tires. In these parts, you want the tires to be at the same angle all the way through the straight. Like, to swing the back out 140 degrees to either side, Man, look at that guy go. So, it's up to a driver and his crew chief to figure out what setup's best for their style and the track. Steering angles! Make sure you subscribe, it's how we get to do cool things and go to places like Dai's Garage. And thanks again to LastPass for sponsoring this video. We got so many different accounts here at Donut. We use LastPass to manage all of that. Seriously, we used to be at events and being like, hey, Eddie, what's the password for Instagram? And then you wind up getting locked out. LastPass relieves the trouble of looking for passwords and the anxiety around getting locked out of your accounts. With LastPass, you don't have to write, remember, reset your passwords. It lets you keep track of them easily, so you can stay sane, like me. Put your passwords on autopilot with LastPass. How's it work? LastPass autofills your credentials on mobile sites and apps for iOS and Android. When you open up an app or a site, it just fills in your username and password for you, making a login easy. You get unlimited password storage, free cross-device sync, and password breach alert, where they send you an alert if your password is breached. Click the link below to find out more about LastPass. We got a bunch of new shows on the horizon, and subscribing helps us make them. Special thanks to Dai Yoshihara for letting us visit his garage to take a look at that sweet, sweet drift missile. Follow him at Dai Yoshihara. Follow us at Donut Media. Follow me at Bits Bardo. Check out this episode on Turbo. And check out this latest episode of Miracle Whips, because it's pretty cool. Don't tell my wife I rented a garage next to Dai's. That's not weird.